Hi, my name is Risa, and I'm a course developer at Point Blank Music School. Today we're at Point Blank LA, and I'm going to be showing you my deconstruction on No Tears Left to Cry by Ariana Grande. I'm sure you know the song, but let's listen to the first half of the song together. Ain't got no tears in my body, I ran out, but boy, I like it. I like it, I like it. Don't matter how, what, when, who tries it, we out here vibing. Alright, so that's the song. As you can see, it has more than 844 million plays on YouTube today, which obviously makes this song a huge hit. Before we get started with the deconstruction, let's go through some facts about the track. So, No Tears Left to Cry is written by Ariana Grande, Max Martin, Savan Kotecha, and Ilya Samanzara. It is produced by Max Martin and Ilya, and the vocal is by Ariana Grande. The single was released on April 20th in 2018 on Republic Records. The style of this song is dance pop disco with a UK garage beat. No Tears Left to Cry was the first single released after the Manchester bombing incident, which occurred during her tour in 2017. And she wanted this song to touch on the incident, but not dwell on it, be hopeful and talk about positivity and love. I think her intention is very well reflected, not just in terms of the lyrics, but also in terms of the song structure, which we will look into today. So let's get started with the deconstruction. I'm going to be using Logic Pro X today, and I also have a MIDI keyboard to record the sounds. There are mainly three sections, verse, pre-chorus, chorus, and I'm going to start with the drums. Let me quickly show you what sounds I have. I have a kick, snare, another kick layered with a shaker, hi-hat, filtered kick and snare, and a ride cymbal. And I'm also going to be adding a shaker loop as well as a stretch clap. Let's start with the kick and snare. So let's take a look. Before the downbeat, there's a note every other bar. And this kick pattern emphasizes the downbeat and is very important in creating the energy and the skippy feel. I'm going to select these notes, take them off the grid, bring them closer to the downbeat. Also bring their velocities down so that this downbeat is even more emphasized. Now I'm going to select these notes and copy and paste them right above where I have the second kick. Reduce their velocities and let's have a listen. Sounds good. Next, I'm going to add the hi-hat. So I have two notes, but I made this one's pitch to be slightly higher than the other, so it's easy to create a movement. Oh, I forgot to mention that everything that I record in should be automatically quantized because I have the quantize setting on in the region inspector. I'm going to select these notes, come to functions, MIDI transform, and select fixed note length. This is to assign all of these notes the same note length. I'm going to click operate only, and you can see now that their note lengths are equal. Let's make this a little bit shorter. And I'm going to come back to functions, MIDI transform, and this time I'm going to select random velocity. Set the highest velocity at 100, lowest at 80, click operate only. And now you can see that the note colors have changed because there's a velocity variation in between 100 and 80. I use this MIDI transform function all the time because it helps me make my percussion more lively and more humanized. Let's also add some swing. I'm going to bring the slider up to around 63. And let's have a listen. Now I'm going to move to the next track and use these two sounds to recreate the garage rhythm, which is one of the most important elements of this track. I'm going to quantize them using the same swing setting that I just used for the hi-hat because I want them to sound cohesive. But I actually don't want these last two notes to be affected by the swing, so let me quickly fix that. And before we listen to it, I'm also going to add a shaker loop. Let's just drag and drop this here. Repeat it. And by itself, this shaker loop is very quiet. Let's listen to the whole thing. So we just created the main drum pattern, and this drum pattern repeats pretty much throughout the track. So I'm going to repeat these until the end of the chorus. But we still need to add a few more details, and one of them is this ride cymbal. I'm going to use this sound to layer the snare in the chorus. All right, let's repeat this. And you can see that this sound really helps the chorus to be more spacey and grand compared to the rest of the track. Lastly, I need to add a stretch clap, which sounds like this. It's like a huge white noise. I made this sound by stretching a clap with Pole Stretch. Pole Stretch is a third-party plugin, which is a great tool for extreme sound stretching like this. Anyway, let me drag and drop this. And this is going to be the transition from the pre-chorus to chorus. It comes in exactly right here, so let me place it there. Put some fade in and also fade out, but this is too long, so make this shorter. And I'm going to put a big fade out. Repeat this sound at the second half of the chorus, but this time it comes in slightly earlier. And when this noise comes in, the rest of the drum tracks stop just for a second, so I'm going to recreate that section by chopping these and the shaker loop. Okay, let's listen to the whole thing. Cool, we're done with the drums. Let's move on to the keys. The key signature of this song is A minor, and the scale used is A natural minor. The notes in the scale are A, B, C, D, E, F, G, and A. No flats or sharps, it's a very simple scale. The first chord progression goes like this: A major, F major, and G major. What's unique about this chord progression is that it starts off with A major chord, A, C sharp, E, which doesn't belong to the key of this song. It's supposed to be A minor. But by blending this A major chord, the song stays uplifting and bright even though it's in a minor key. And I think this mixture of minor and major chords is a great technique for delivering the message behind this song, because it's not really a completely happy song, but it's rather a transition from going through a hardship to living optimistically. Another thing to mention about these chords is that all of them are add to chords, meaning that they are major triads with an additional note. For example, this is A major triad, A, C sharp, E, but when you add B, it becomes an add to chord. Okay, let's record. So for the sound, I'm gonna layer a few different instruments. I have two bells from Alchemy, and I have two synthesizer strings. I also have this percussion sound. This is to intensify the attack of these chords. I'm also going to turn off the quantize setting because I want to record arpeggios, meaning that I want to break up the chords like this rather than trying to play them at the same time. Let's record using this bell instrument, starting at the verse. Okay, let's take a look. I'm going to edit the note positions manually. So let's bring the velocities up a little bit. That looks good. Looks good. And shorten their note lengths too. Okay, let me fix the details. Just bear with me for a second. All right, now I'm going to copy and paste this MIDI region on the rest of the instruments. And for the cosmic strings, I'm going to bring them an octave lower. And for the percussion, I need only one note, so I'm going to erase everything but the bass notes and bring them all to C4, where I have the percussion. Without any effects, they sound like this. So it sounds a little bit too plain. On the summing channel, I have some effects ready. I have Logic Channel EQ cutting low frequency, some reverb by Native Instruments, distortion. This plugin is by Plugin Alliance, and Logic's compressor. Let's listen to it again. So those effects really make a big difference. They made a sound warmer and richer. I'm going to repeat this until the chorus. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to layer these chords even further using these tracks. Both of them are Logic's ES2 synthesizer, and I'm attaching some white noise. This is without the white noise, and this is together with the white noise. Yeah, so it definitely adds more presence to it. I'm going to copy and paste this MIDI region on the first layer track, bring them an octave lower. So the first layer sounds like this by itself. Repeat this. And for the second layer, I'm going to copy and paste the same MIDI region, but I only want to emphasize the lower notes, so I'm going to delete everything but the bass notes. Bring them an octave lower and repeat this. And during the pre-chorus, I'm going to add some harmony. I'm going to copy and paste these notes an octave and a third higher. And now it sounds like this. Okay, let's listen to the whole thing in the pre-chorus. Alright, we're done with the first chord progression. Let's move on to the second chord progression, which is in the chorus. So the chorus is totally different from the verse and the pre-chorus. There's no more majorized chord, and it sounds more dramatic and melancholic. I have three bell instruments ready, all from Alchemy, and I also have another ES2 synthesizer. This is to layer these bells. Let's record using this bell. And I'm going to put the quantize setting back on. I'm going to assign them fixed note length by coming to Functions, MIDI Transform, and Fixed Note Length. Click Operate Only, and let's extend their note lengths a little bit and bring their velocities up as well. Now I'm going to copy and paste this MIDI region onto the rest of the bell instruments, and for the last bell, I want to bring them an octave higher. And now I'm going to layer these bells using this ES2 synthesizer. Let me make a new region. I'm just going to extend their note length slightly because I don't want big gaps in between the notes. They look good. Okay. So one thing to note about this second chord progression is that it ends with C major chord, which is a tonic chord of the relative major key of A minor. And this chord gives us such a positive and optimistic feeling, even though the entire chorus is in minor. And I think this kind of structure, again, helps delivering the optimism behind the song. All right, we're done with the keys. Let's move on to the bass. So I'm going to be using Native Instruments Contact Scarby J bass, as well as Logic's EXS24 sine wave as the sub bass. Let's record starting at the verse. So the bass line is very simple. They are the same notes as the root notes of the chord progression. Let me just check if the notes are not overlapping with each other, and I'm going to copy this on the sub bass track. Bring them an octave lower and bring the velocities down just a little bit. And for the sub bass only, there's a note that comes in at the end of every four bars, right here on C. Let me just type this in, and I'm going to repeat this until the end of the pre-chorus. I just gotta delete this note at the end. Let's have a listen. So the bass line is parallel with the lead vocal and the chord progression pretty much throughout the track, and it glues all the melodic elements together and helps them stay in sync. I'm going to record for the entire chorus. Okay, so you probably noticed that I recorded shorter notes during the first half of the chorus and sustained notes during the second half of the chorus. This is because all the melodic elements like bells and synthesizer, they come in at the second half of the chorus, and the second half of the chorus acts as the climax of the song, so I think the bass line is accommodating that change. Let me quickly check. Nothing is wrong. And I'm going to copy and paste this MIDI region on the sub bass track. Do the same processing, bring them an octave lower and bring their velocities down. So this, as you can see, this leaves the first half of the chorus pretty empty. The only melodic element there is the bass. This is when the pad instruments come in. I have three pads, all from Alchemy, and I'm going to be using these two for the chorus. Let's record starting at the beginning of the chorus. I'm going to add some lower notes too. So I recorded this dissonance, it's E and F, on purpose. But I want this to be subtle, so I'm going to reduce the velocity of note F really low. And I'm going to copy and paste this on the second pad. Bring the overall velocities down. And repeat these for the second half of the chorus. And this is a little bit of mixing, but I'm going to pan the first pad to the left just a little bit. And for the second pad, I have channel EQ, compressor, and this plugin called Phasis. It's a phaser plugin by Native Instruments. I'm putting these effects because I want the pads to be on the sides and create some space. Let's listen to the entire chorus. Sounds good. The last melodic element that we need to add is this pad during the pre-chorus. Let me quickly record the MIDI notes. So as you can see, it's just a long sustained note, and it sounds very plain at the moment. But we're going to fix this by automating its cutoff. So I'm going to open the channel strip, change this mode to touch, open Alchemy's editor, and I'm going to play this section again. And while it's playing, I'm going to tweak the cutoff knob just a little bit. That's enough. Close this, put this mode back to read. And now when I open the automation menu by pressing A, there should be a value for Alchemy's cutoff. Now I can manually assign the value. Let's raise this up to around 52 and start very low, around 8. Let's listen to it. So even if it's just one note, because of the automation, this pad plays a very important role in increasing the tension overall towards the chorus. All right, we're done with all the arrangements. Now I just need to add a vinyl sample for the texture. By itself, it sounds like this. It's very subtle, but it definitely makes a difference. It makes the track warmer and richer, and this is something I do all the time for my own production. Okay, let's listen to the whole Deconstruction track with the a cappella. Alright, so that was a deconstruction of No Tears Left to Cry. I hope you enjoyed it. Thank you very much for watching. Make sure to check out pointblankmusicschool.com to find out more about studying here. We'll see you next time.